All right. Do you know what that theme song means? That's right. It's another episode of the Senator Omer Raines Show. We invite you to listen to us at 1180 AM KCKQ, a Lotus broadcast radio station, as well as around the world on AmericaMatters.us. The creator and the host of the show invite you to come join us here at the Reno Town Mall, get in the audience, or get behind a microphone. You can also text in questions to our chief engineer, Craig Moss, at 775-237-2266. But if you would like to speak with Senator Omer Raines or his guests, that number is 844-790-TALK. Again, it's 844-790-8255. Without further ado, let's get to the creator and host of the Senator Omer Raines Show, Senator Omer Raines.
Thank you, Eddie. Good afternoon, folks. I'm Omer Raines, welcoming you to America Matters Media, broadcasting this program to the world, not only in English, but by way of translation in various other languages as well. The programs are being broadcast live on air in the United States and worldwide via various social media applications. Now, this program, by my choice, is intended to be eclectic in nature. Thus, it doesn't focus solely on one topic or subject matter. However, the guest in whatever fit the field, whatever the point of view, is always interesting and well-informed. Nevertheless, whatever the topic, whomever the guest, we encourage diverse points of view. Okay, Eddie gave you the call-in and text numbers. And with that in mind, I want to introduce today's guest, Dr. William Torch, a multifaceted person, as you are about to find out. One facet is, indeed, that of a medical practitioner, a very distinguished one. However, to me, the more interesting facet of his life is that of a renowned inventor with over 75 patents to his name. He has received so many recognitions, awards, honors, and publications, they go on for 16 pages in his curriculum vitae, single space. So we aren't going to go through all of that today. It would consume all the time. But his is a truly Horatio Alger story, and you're going to find it especially interesting, that I can assure. So again, welcome, Dr. Torch.
Thank you very much, Homer. It's great being with you today.
Let's start with your upbringing. Where were you born, and tell us a bit about the way in which you were raised.
I was born in Brooklyn, New York, and raised there, where I lived until I was around 18, before I moved away. My parents were both immigrants, or came from immigrant families. My father was born in Russia around 1890 or so, and came to the United States with four other brothers and a sister, escaping from Tsarist Russia before the revolution. He came to Chicago, where he became an upholsterer and was an opera singer as well. On my mother's side, she was of Polish origin. She was born in the United States. Both parents came from Warsaw, again, to escape the pogroms and the political issues that were terrorizing that country in the late 1800s. My mother was born in 1905, and I was born in 1942. New York.
So it doesn't sound as though you were born with a silver spoon in your mouth.
No, not at all. As a matter of fact, my father died when I was around 11 years old. We were very poor. I was on New York City aid to dependent children welfare and could not have survived without government and city support.
But yet you went on and went through school, I assume, in New York and eventually college and medical school. Tell us just a bit about that.
Well, I was very lucky to have been born in New York City and to grow up in that wonderful town. I had access to City University, went to Brooklyn College after finishing my high school training at Abraham Lincoln High School, and lived and grew up in New York City until I moved away to the University of Rochester School of Medicine, where I did my MD degree. But I must say that having had free City University at Brooklyn College, City University of New York, was the start of a wonderful career. And I couldn't have done it without public support.
It sounds to me as though, knowing something about your background, that your inventive side, if you will, started relatively early in life. Is that true?
Absolutely. And I have to say that my creative spirit evolved as a result of poverty. I couldn't afford toys when I was a kid, and I had to make my own. I made my first bow and arrow, a wooden gun. I've made scooters, shoeshine boxes, and went on to make other devices that satisfied my childhood needs. And I've always been inventive through high school and into college. And then finally, for the rest of my life, I've been an inventor as well as a physician.
Now, I understand through perseverance and just the need for acquisition of knowledge that you studied and began to speak multiple languages. Is that true?
Yes. In addition to knowing a little Hebrew and trained in that language when I was a youngster, I went on to study French and German. I'm not terribly fluent in those, but I can read in those two languages. And a knowledge of foreign languages really helped me as well in some of the research activities that I was involved with subsequently.
But there's one other that intrigues me that I know about you. You actually learned Braille.
Yes. When I was in high school, there was a wonderful experience that I had. Several women who were nuns from the Plymouth Church in Brooklyn, New York, came to Abraham Lincoln High School, and they tried to recruit students to learn Braille to help the blind. They wanted students to volunteer to learn Braille and then transcribe books, written books, into Braille for the blind through the U.S. Congress, Congressional Library. And I took courses in Braille and then had to transcribe a book or a chapter by Isaac Asimov, The Color of Outer Space, and I received my Braille license eventually.
Really, really fascinating. Please, I'm going to interrupt you because we're going to go to a short commercial break. Audience, please stay tuned. This is going to be a great program. We'll be right back.
Hey, everyone. This is Ankit Shukla. And I'm here today to talk about my book, Don't Live the Good Life, Live the Better Life, which I self-published in 2013. In Don't Live the Good Life, Live the Better Life, I discuss the idea of not just settling for good, but always going for better in both our personal and professional lives. I'm very proud of this book, and I believe that it will help and inspire millions of people around the world. And I hope that everybody reads it, enjoys it, and gets something out of it. Don't Live the Good Life, Live the Better Life can be picked up at Amazon.com or xlibris.com. That's xlibris.com. Also, please follow me on my website, theevenbetterlife.com. That's theevenbetterlife.com. I write on there regularly, and please feel free to comment on anything I put on there. I would love to hear from you. And please pick up a copy of my book and let me know what you think. Don't live the good life, live the better life. And please follow me on my website, theevenbetterlife.com.
At SafeLight, we know how busy your life can be.
Oh, no.
This mom didn't have time to worry about a cracked windshield, so she scheduled at safelight.com. And with SafeLight's exclusive On My Way text, she knew exactly when I'd be there. Hi, Steve with SafeLight.
Thanks for your text.
I replaced her windshield, and she didn't miss a single shot, giving you more time for what matters most. How'd you do?
We won.
Nice. That's another SafeLight advantage.
Thank you so much.
SafeLight repair, SafeLight replace.
In today's economy, it's more important than ever to take care of your money. Proper wealth management strategies are essential to help you achieve your retirement income goals. The talented wealth specialists at Sierra Financial Advisors will focus on developing smart, innovative strategies to help you to protect and grow your nest egg. Katie Coombs has been a financial advisor for 16 years and specializes in estate planning, investment planning, retirement planning, education planning, and insurance planning. Katie and her team at Sierra Financial Advisors will focus on cultivating a long-term relationship with you to develop and implement smart wealth-building strategies so you can handle whatever life throws at you. To make an appointment for your no-cost consultation, please call Katie Coombs at Sierra Financial Advisors at 775-885-8847 or find us online at sfallc.com. Securities offered through First Global Capital Corp. Member FINRA SIPC. Investment advisory services offered through First Global Advisors, Inc. Insurance services offered through Sierra Financial Advisors. Sierra Financial Advisors and First Global Capital Corp. are unaffiliated entities.
So you think this chip is nothing to worry about? Well, it's SafeLight. We know sooner or later, every chip will crack. These friends were on a trip when their windshield got chipped. So they scheduled at SafeLight.com. They didn't have to change their plans or worry about a thing.
I'll see y'all in a little bit.
And I fixed it right away with a strong repair they can trust. Plus, with most insurance, a SafeLight repair is no cost to you.
Really?
Being there whenever you need us, that's another SafeLight advantage.
SafeLight repair, SafeLight replace.
Welcome back, everyone. We have with us again today Dr. William Torch. He has over 75 patents to his name. He's the former president of the Nevada Inventors Association. And in fact, that's how I came to know him, because he was developing an extraordinary invention that's bound to amaze the listening audience. And I was brought in at a point in time as a potential consultant. ICOM is its name, and that's the invention I'm going to ask the doctor to drill down on today, because we can't cover many of his inventions. But I want you to explain the way in which your medical practice morphed into the development of some of your inventive products, in this case, especially ICOM. Let's start with the beginning, back when you began to think in terms of what eventually was an ICOM type of development.
Well, I came to Nevada in 1979. I joined the University of Nevada School of Medicine as a faculty member and became the first board-certified pediatric neurologist in the state of Nevada. I began to see lots and lots of children and adults as a pediatric neurologist. And I just retired just a few weeks ago. And during this course of practice, I calculated that I've seen over 240,000 patient visits. Among these were patients who were severely affected by neurological diseases. Lou Gehrig's disease, for example, cerebral palsy, muscular dystrophy. I was the director of the Muscular Dystrophy Association clinic at St. Mary's Hospital for many years, and I saw many helpless patients who were in need of the technology that finally evolved. One of the patients, I have to say, was the first inspiration. His name was Glenn. Glenn was approximately 28-year-old male who had a stroke following a brainstem encephalitis that left him in a coma. He was unconscious in St. Mary's Hospital for several weeks on a ventilator, unable to respond to any stimuli. We were thinking about pulling the plug, and thank God we did not. I would go over to his bedside and pinch him and try to stimulate him to see if he was awake and responsive. There was absolutely no movement or response. Then one day, I did the same, and all of a sudden, he started blinking, and he opened his eyes, and I said to Glenn, "Can you hear me?" And he started to blink with a flurry of eye blinks. And I said, "Are you there? Can you communicate with me?" No response. I said, "Glenn, do me a favor. Blink three times." And he blinked. Buzz, bzz, bzz. I said, "Blink seven times. Bzz, 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 bzz." I said, "How much is 15 take away 5? And he gave me 10 blinks. And I knew he was awake, alert, but he was totally paralyzed from the eyes down, and he had a condition that we finally diagnosed as locked-in syndrome. I had this crazy idea of developing a blink detector and converting his blinks, short and long, into Morse code. For example, a short blink would be bzzz, a long blink would be bzzz, and through a series of Morse code-like eye movements, he was able to communicate in that manner. I went to Radio Shack with my inventive capacity, bought an infrared emitter and a detector pair and a 9-volt battery and a breadboard that that supported as a platform all the electrical connections, and with the premise that I could aim it at my eye and pick up a reflected infrared light coming off my eyelid versus my eyeball, that I would be able to create buzzing sounds and light signals. And I did that, and amazingly, it worked. And that was the birth of ICOM 1.
How much did that cost?
$2.50 in inflationary costs at the time.
And a lot of brain power.
Well, that was free.
So you were experimenting with rapid eye movement, or what we call REM, very early on, were you not?
Yes, but when you talk about REM, you're talking about nocturnal sleep, and that's movement of the eyeball under a closed lid. There are people who are doing studies on REM that have actually inquired about the use of my ICOM biosensor communicator and controller from Stanford University and Google, actually. And that's a future application. But it started out with simple eye blinks in the waking state.
Just by way of evolution of thought, you began to study REM even before you came to Nevada, right?
I was a resident in neurology at Albert Einstein Medical Center. And there was a fellow by the name of Elliot Weitzman, who was one of the founders of American sleep medicine on the East Coast, who compares to Dr. Bill Dement from Stanford on the West Coast. And Dr. Weitzman was actually studying REM in children, in neonates, and animals in the basement of Montefiore Hospital. And it was a very bizarre science. It was what we call dark science because it was done at night. And and I met Dr. Weitzman, and I didn't understand or know anything about what he was doing, but subsequently learned all about sleep disorders. And when I came to Reno after starting the Neurodevelopmental and Neurodiagnostic Center, I experimented with the foundation of the Washoe Sleep Disorder Center, which started out around 1992. And over the next 15 to 16 years, was accredited by the American Academy of Sleep Medicine on 4 different occasions. During that period, I've seen literally thousands of patients with sleep apnea, narcolepsy, both adults and children, and approximately 70 other sleep disorders.
So were you also studying some of the less well-known, maybe, like ADD or various neurological disorders?
That's a fascinating question. In the cross current between pediatric neurology and sleep disorders medicine, I began to realize that a lot of the children that I was seeing with ADD were very sleepy kids. I would put them in front of a test called the TOVA test, test of variable attentiveness used to diagnose ADD. And I would see through a camera that they were falling asleep in front of this very, very boring cognitive performance test. And I decided to...
We can all do that.
Yes. And something also astounding occurred. My narcolepsy patients had a higher incidence of ADD than any of the other patients that I had. And I began to realize that there was an intimate relationship between ADD, sleep deprivation, insomnia, the consequences of sleep apnea, and a myriad of other sleep disorders, including periodic limb movement disorder, restless leg syndrome, et cetera, et cetera. And I did an initial study. I looked at EEG to look at microsleeps in children during the waking state and looked at their eyes with an infrared camera in the dark, and I saw that there was a correlation between their errors of omission and commission that led to the diagnosis of ADD on that test and the relationship to long and short blinks, particularly very long blinks that were 2 to 3 seconds long, indicating drowsiness. ICOM 1 became ICOM 2 with the knowledge that I could now not only measure blink frequency, but blink duration. And I put a buzzer and a light source, a visible light source on ICOM 1 and created ICOM 2. Then on ICOM 3, I put a filter that could eliminate normal blinks and only capture and measure long blinks. And lo and behold, I had a drowsiness detector as well. So ICOM 3 was clearly not only the first beginnings of an invention that was to be called the biosensor communicator and controller to help paralyzed and enabled people to control their environment and the computers with their eyes, and also at the same time studying the implications of eye movement metrics as a function of drowsiness and ADD. I also did a study on children looking at the correlation between their ADD score, their drowsiness measures in a simulator, and also truck drivers in the same in the Washoe Sleep Disorder Center, and came to the ultimate conclusion that ADD, to a large extent, is a result of sleep disturbance.
Now, you were also working with various types of neurological impairment, correct?
Yes.
Now, the person in the world probably most famous in this regard would be Dr. Stephen Hawking. Have you ever met him or dealt with him?
Yes. As a matter of fact, ICOM 3 became ICOM 4, then ICOM 5, and then finally ICOM 6, which was funded by grants from the CDC, the U.S. Army, and ultimately the Department of Transportation, NHTSA, and various military organizations.
Let's get to that in just a moment, but tell me about your involvement with Dr. Hawking before we take our next commercial break.
Oh, in the process of doing work on the grants, I met a fellow who was working with Stephen Hawking in Cape Canaveral, and I was invited my doctor friend to accompany him to see Stephen Hawking's zero-G flight. At the meeting in Florida, I met Professor Hawking, and this led to 4 subsequent visits and the development of the Hawkeye project.
Okay, we're going to pick up on that when we return for another commercial break. Audience, please stay with us. The best is yet to come.
Hi, I'm Pascal from Safelite. My customer's daughter was driving when a rock flew up and chipped her windshield. They wanted it repaired right before it could crack. So they scheduled online at Safelite.com. Hey, Safelite's repair resin fills the chip's tiniest microcracks. No other resin lasts longer or stays stronger. There's even a national lifetime warranty. Plus, thanks to his insurance, a Safelite repair was no cost to him.
Really?
Call or schedule online.
Safelite Repair, Safelite Replace.
Do you judge a book by its cover? Then you'll love the amazing book cover art, #1 award winner, A Reluctant Spirit. In this true story, Kathleen Berry joins a TV news crew and paranormal investigators as the team's impartial observer. Their first stop, Central Nevada's Goldfield Hotel. In A Reluctant Spirit, Berry shares a 12-hour overnight odyssey in the reportedly haunted 4-story hotel. It pulverizes the author's religiously narrow beliefs. Kathleen Berry, a longtime skeptic, is forced to view the paranormal through a different lens. Is it evil? Figments of the weak-minded? When ghosts confront her, how does she reconcile her Christianity and the spiritual encounters? Get your copy of A Reluctant Spirit by Kathleen Berry online at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, or at LaRue Press in Reno, Nevada. Award-winning A Reluctant Spirit, a true tale of God, ghosts, and a skeptical Christian. Buy it today at lrpnv.com.
So you think all auto glass companies are the same? Well, they're not. When your windshield needs to be replaced, nobody makes it as worry-free as Safelite. First, Safelite emails a photo of the technician, so you know who to expect and how soon.
Right on time.
Safelite's one-of-a-kind TrueSeal technology places the new glass in perfect position for a strong, reliable bond you can trust.
Wow, that looks great.
You're all set?
Thank you so much.
Schedule now to get the Safelite advantage.
Safelite Repair, Safelite Replace.
Are you planning to move? Paragon Real Estate Resources can help you sell or buy a home anywhere in the United States.
We provide a home resources coordinator to manage all aspects of your move. We recommend qualified real estate agents and other services to prepare your home for sale. Best of all, if you sell or buy a home with our assistance, you could be eligible to receive a tax-free real estate commission cash rebate. We can also help you obtain a mortgage at competitive interest rates. Our lenders offer fixed and adjustable rates, conforming and non-conforming loans, plus FHA and VA financing. We can also assist first-time buyers with as little as 5% down. And when it comes time to move, we can refer you to qualified movers or other companies to assist with self-moves. Paragon Real Estate Resources helps make moving as easy as possible. Call Paragon Real Estate Resources now at 1-800-235-7513 to learn more or visit ParagonRERI.com.
Welcome back, folks. Again, Omar Raines. Our guest today is Dr. William Torch, and we're focused not on his medical practice, but rather on some of his inventive background, and specifically on one invention that truly has the potential to reshape the world in many ways, as you will learn. Now, I interrupted you to go to commercial break, Dr. Torch. You were talking about Stephen Hawking. Continue, please.
Yes, I saw Stephen off at Cape Canaveral, NASA, when he went off on a zero-G flight. And on the bus, while I was on route to the tarmac, I met his caretakers and told them about the early stages of invention of ICOM 1 through 5, and I was just about to embark on ICOM 6 around 2001. By the time I met Hawking, I had come quite far in the evolution of this technology. I continued back in Reno to develop ICOM 6 and ultimately ICOM 7 and 8. Shortly after the zero-G flight, I was in Ireland at a funeral of my family, one of my family members, and asked my wife if it was all right to call Hawking at Cambridge University. I did so. And after speaking to his caretaker, I was asked if I could fly over the next morning, which I was so excited to do. I flew over and met the distinguished professor, and what was supposed to be a 30-minute visit turned out to be...
That was at Cambridge University?
Cambridge University in England, yes. And I went to the Center of Mathematics and met Professor Hawking, who was sitting in his wheelchair, and... controlling his computer with his twitch switch, which is connected to his iframe. And I brought a CD and a DVD of my accomplishments up to that point and showed it to him. And the half hour turned into a 3-hour presentation. And I was subsequently invited back to examine Professor Hawking with my brother-in-law, who's an ophthalmologist, and we did an eye examination determining his visual characteristics, and I received a pair of his glasses, physical glasses, and I decided that we were going to build ICOM 7 and 8, and I created the Hawkeye Project. And in the process, he signed a collaborative agreement with me for the Hawkeye Project, and he signed it with his thumbprint, a very valuable inheritance, and also he and his associates wrote some wonderful comments in the books that he had written about the cosmos. I came back to Cambridge on two other occasions and then met his caretakers at Caltech Pasadena and was just on the verge of delivering the Hawkeye model to Professor Hawking to control not only his computers with his eyes, to increase his typing speed from 0.5, one half a word per minute, which he was doing with his facial twitch switch, to increase it to up to 15 words a minute with the possibility that this could be employed and welcomed. We also developed a software alphabet board, which could provide eye typing with the ICOM 7 and 8, And that would offer anyone with the ability not only to control an alphanumeric board with their eyes, but to use it as a mouse, eye mouse, as we called it, to control computers for all operations, applications, video games, business, educational, and communication applications. The ICOM 7 was able to operate a wheelchair by means of eye movement. If you sat in the wheelchair, by taking control of the joystick on an electric wheelchair, you could make a wheelchair go where you looked. I was able to ride the wheelchair into an elevator, and we also worked with Otis Elevator engineers, and we were able to control the software that controls an elevator. So by driving that wheelchair into an elevator, it had the potential of controlling the elevator to take you from one floor to the other. ICOM was also able to operate televisions, radios, fans, alarms, and through evolving oculometrics, as we call them, iMouse, we were able to point and click and use dwell movements of eye blink to trigger responses, play video games, action games, as well as static board games like computer chess. I could operate a Kindle book and read and turn pages of the book on a computer with my eyes. One other fantastic achievement that my team was able to accomplish was with Willow Garage out of Palo Alto. Willow had a PR2 robot that was being developed to help paralyzed individuals. I got a copy of that software program. We hooked up ICOM 7 to that, and I was able to operate that PR2 robot, not only in Palo Alto, but 2,000 miles away at Georgia Tech in Atlanta, Georgia. And by watching the movements of a robot, we were able to control the movement of that robot down a hallway, make a turn into a room, come to a desk where there were two cups, a 3-centimeter red and a 3-centimeter green cup, and I could command that robot to lift with its pincers the one cup and put it into the other from 2,000 miles away. This is how precise the capability was. The implications of that for all disabled and enabled individuals, as well as astronauts and people in space, on the moon, and in any environment, to control their environment and communicate, was an absolutely amazing achievement that my staff was able to accomplish.
So this is a story of somebody born into an area and into a family that actually was on welfare.
Yes.
And now you're accomplishing extraordinary, recognizable inventions that are helping the world. I want to, and in effect, by this time, it appears to me that you've become a clinician, a researcher, and an inventor, basically wearing three hats at the same time. Would that be a fair characterization?
Absolutely.
Now, you've walked through a number of iterations of ICOM. I want to go back and do that a bit more slowly. Walk us through the various stages. How did you actually come to the attention of some of the government entities that ended up being of assistance to you?
Well, I developed ICOM 1 through 5 on my own. And while I was the president of the Nevada Inventors Association, I was told about a grant that had been a proposal that had been issued by the Center of Disease Control out of Atlanta, Georgia, as part of the NIH. And I decided to respond to that grant application. And on the day of 9/11, I got a call from the CDC to announce that I had won a $100,000 SBIR grant from that organization. And that began my endeavor to develop ICOM 5 into ICOM 6 with the addition of cameras to a pair of iframes, two endo cameras, one at the base of each eye looking upward at 45 degrees that could capture the image of an eyeball and its pupil, and an exo camera placed above the nose in the bridge of a pair of iframes. And ICOM 6 was now able to not only look at the XY coordinates of the eye, looking at blinks, pupillary size, but also determine where you were looking on a screen in terms of the XY coordinates of that screen, and through triangulation be able to control anything on that computer screen. That was ICOM 6. ICOM 7 made it wireless and Bluetoothable, and ICOM 8 added ergonomics, miniaturization, faster speed, lower power requirements, and cost-cutting capabilities to get it down from the $20,000 per unit down to the several hundred-dollar level of cost, which would make it available to the masses of people, not only in the United States, but more importantly, all over the world, where cost is a major issue.
Now, when I was taken to your office by a mutual acquaintance, Larry Udell, from the Bay Area, I walked into a medical office, and I saw a Dodge Ram truck sliced in half with a wraparound screen.
Yes.
And it's not what you expect when you walk into a doctor's office. Tell us about that, the purpose for it, what it cost.
Well, I was very successful with the CDC grant, and the word got around to the U.S. Department of Transportation in NHTSA and the National Transportation Safety Board about the implications of ICOM in terms of identifying people falling asleep at the wheel. And I thought the next best thing was to test out the hypothesis that I could predict an accident before it occurred. And while there were some flimsy simulators available, I decided to do things in my typical torch way of thinking. And I went down to a local auto chop shop, and I brought a Dodge Ram truck cab up to the office. We cut the cab in half and measured its dimensions down to the centimeter, and I was able to get it off a truck in two parts, up the elevator at Renown Medical Center, through the doors in my office, and then we built a wraparound screen around the simulator, put the whole two halves together, and put the ICOM into that simulator, and we were able to next apply for grants from the U.S. Department of Defense and NHTSA, which we did subsequently.
Doctor, we're going to pick right up on that when we come back. This is our last commercial break. Audience, please stay tuned. You've got to be fascinated by this time.
Do you need high-quality estate planning and family law services? I'm Reno attorney Todd Torvinen. I practice in the areas of estate planning, probate, family law, and divorce taxation. I'm also experienced in probate and family law litigator and believe that prevailing in any litigation requires diligent, methodical preparation. As a certified estate planning law specialist and certified public accountant, I'm singularly qualified to analyze the financial aspects of marital, family assets, or a decedent's estate. A large part of my practice is done in real time. It means that preparation of estate planning and family law documents occurs with the client present, and they're reviewed with the client at the time the client is there. Your documents are examined line by line and explained to you, then modified based upon your input. This client-focused approach leverages the current technology and enhances the attorney-client communication and relationship. The idea is to produce a better product. Please call me at 775-825-6066 to schedule an appointment today. Again, 775-825-6066.
Hey, Ankit Shukla here, traveling nurse, author, and motivational speaker. I am very excited because I get to talk about my book, Don't Live the Good Life, Live the Better Life. In my book, I talk about the idea of always living the better life and not just settling for good. There's a lot of other great ideas in this book, which I hope reaches millions of people across the world because I believe they will help inspire and motivate everyone. That's my main goal in life, is to help and inspire as many people as I possibly can, whether it's as a writer, a speaker, or as a nurse. Don't Live the Good Life, Live the Better Life can be picked up at Amazon.com or XLibris.com. That's XLIBRIS.com. Also, follow me on my website, TheEvenBetterLife.com. Ankit Shukla, Don't Live the Good Life, Live the Better Life, TheEvenBetterLife.com.
This is Rick Parr, Director of Sales and host of Talking Sports on America Matters Media. Listen up. We are looking for some good people to sell advertising with us. America Matters Media is our area's community radio network based right here in Reno and heard all over the world with excellent programming throughout the week. If you have sales experience or a great personality with positive attitude and can communicate well, call us at 775-827-8900. We'll train you on how to get the deal done. You'll earn money immediately on every sale you make and on every renewal. The facts are that every business needs help getting the word out about their products and services, and radio ads help them do just that by letting our listeners know where to go to get the best deals in town. We want you to help us bring our clients and listeners together with advertising sales. Call now, 775-827-8900. That's America Matters Media, 827-8900.
At Safe Flight, we know how busy life can be. These kids were headed to their first dance recital
when their windshield got cracked, but they couldn't miss the show.
So Dad went to the new SafeFlight.com, and in just a few clicks, he scheduled a replacement before the girls even took the stage. SafeFlight.com is the fast, easy way to schedule service anywhere in America, so you don't have to miss a thing.
Hey, y'all did wonderful.
That's another Safe Flight advantage.
Safe Flight Repair, Safe Flight Replace.
Welcome back, folks. Omar Raines here with our guest, Dr. William Torch. So, Dr. Torch, there came a point in time when you came to the attention of the Department of Defense. I know that. When and for what reason? Could you tell us briefly what that was all about and what inspired them to become involved?
Well, I completed the work with the CDC, and I went to a conference in Washington, D.C. It was called New Technologies in Drive of Vigilance, and I demonstrated my original ICOM idea, and people who looked at it, a scientist looked at it and said, oh, no one's going to wear that. And I was convinced that they were absolutely wrong, and I was kind of happy that they saw it that way because they weren't going to enter my space. And I continued with ICOM 6. The next year's conference was called New Ocular Technologies in Drive and Vigilance, and I was invited to that conference to do a presentation. At that meeting, Colonel Michael Russo, a neurologist and sleep specialist like myself, met me. He was astounded by the capability, and he saw its relevance in monitoring the eyes of helicopter pilots. I was invited to Fort Rucker, Alabama, where they did studies on the ICOM-6 in a Black Hawk helicopter and determined that it did not interfere with the operation of the helicopter's mechanics, and it could be used to identify human factors, the conditions of its pilots. The U.S. Army decided to create an Army SBIR grant for $75,000, which we won. And upon completion of that project, which had demonstrated its application in a driving simulator and in a Black Hawk helicopter, we were invited by the U.S. Department of Defense to apply for a U.S. Congressional Research Initiative. And over the next 7 years, we received ICOM Corporation received $15 million in grants to develop the ICOM 7 and 8, employing approximately 25 engineers, software, hardware individuals, and myself, which I did part-time, and continued on the project. The project ended up with the evolution and development of an application for close to 50 U.S. patents, as well as foreign patents and well. And we won commendation not only from the Department of Defense and NHTSA, U.S. Department of Transportation, but multiple other entities that awarded ICOM Corporation with the National Tibbetts Awards for its accomplishment under the SBIR program.
So, and that's a very coveted award, I happen to know. You were also named the given the Nevada Entrepreneurship Award, were you not?
Yes, that was many years ago.
Yeah. So we now have the Department of Defense increasingly interested, and your goal, as I understand, your your comments was to make the eyewear activate basically any body part, not just the eye. Is that correct?
Well, it could be used for control of robots, and you can imagine robotic appendages that could be attached to a human body. Think of all the veterans who've been injured in wars, and children and adults in blast explosions. So the capability of helping disabled individuals, whether in the civilian world or military world, is simply astounding.
So this must have been an incredibly expensive project. I mean, we know that DOD alone, $15 million in grants plus other grants you were receiving. Was your goal also to make it something that eventually could be purchased right off the shelf?
Not off the shelf necessarily, but that would have been a commendable goal. When we were developing ICOM 7 and 8 and building it literally by hand under a binocular microscope with all the hours that went into creating one communicator, biosensor, and controller, we were talking about $15,000 to $20,000 per unit. The goal was to bring it down into the real world, to bring the cost down to the $200 or $300 mark. There were some technical problems with the operation that we had to work on over many years, and we finally got it to the point where we were able to demonstrate its the possibility of it using it in head-mounted displays so for virtual reality and augmentative reality applications. And in the process, ICOM Corporation needed additional funding, which we got from private investors. And iFluence, a new corporation, a spinoff of ICOM Corporation, took over in 2013. And funded the project with another $20 million, approximately, from private investors as well as Intel and Motorola. They impressed Google with the accomplishments by incorporating the technology into Google Glass. And finally, Google approached iFluence and asked if they could acquire all the technology. And October 24th, 2016, I'm proud to say that iFluence has moved within Google as Google iFluence and is now working on incorporation of ICOM technology into head-mounted displays for the average consumer, for virtual reality and augmentative reality applications. This was also the desire of Professor Hawking, who also wanted to incorporate artificial intelligence applications into the technology, and that is being done as we speak. I predict that the cost of the ICOM technology as it evolves will bring it down to the $200 to $300 mark, making it available for all humanity.
So we have a story here, as I understand what you've told us. You start with a invention, if you will, a development that cost you $2.50 to make, and it has gotten to the point where ICOM developed and morphed, if you will, into a company called iFluence, which has, in addition, began the attention of Google and is now part of the Google empire, and is continuous development under that heading. Is that correct?
Absolutely. I'm very proud.
What a story. My Lord. Where is the technology going from here? I mean, you've talked about virtual reality, and you've talked about some things that you have in mind. Is it actually going in that direction?
Yes. As a matter of fact, I was invited to Google headquarters about 2 months ago, and I was given a wonderful tour, not only of Google, but Google X. And I'm proud to say that iFluence is currently in the process of continuing in its journey to develop the technology for mass use. And I predict that within the next year or two, it will find its way into Google Dreamwear head-mounted displays that can be purchased at Best Buy, for example, for $100 or so. The addition of eye tracking may bring the price up a notch, maybe another $2.50. But I believe that the technology will have universal application and accessibility by everyone, disabled, enabled, in all applications, civilian, military, educational, scientific, the arts, music, et cetera, et cetera.
So, Doctor, as you wind down your medical career, what do you have in mind for yourself? I mean, you're obviously a man of extraordinary ability and talent and a lot yet to contribute. What do you have in mind?
Well, I think your choice of words is wrong. It's not winding down. It's winding up.
I salute you.
And I am not retiring. I thought I could retire, but I've been called by so many individuals who've asked me to help them on research projects, children involved. And I'm proud to say that a museum associated with the Smithsonian has been in discussion with me about creating an ICOM exhibit showing how an idea can turn into a prototype and into an invention with final commercialization potential. And the ICOM story begins with the $2.50 idea that's turned into a Google product is simply beyond my own belief.
So if you go forward with the exhibit project at a museum, do you have any idea what your title would be?
Well, some of the individuals I've been speaking to have decided to create one called Inventor in Residence.
I like it.
And as an inventor in residence, I will be giving talks locally, and hopefully I can get the word out nationally and perhaps even internationally to let people and the world know about this wonderful accomplishments by ICOM Corporation engineers and personnel, iFluence, and now Google.
So is it your intent to lecture, maybe to write, and certainly to go forward with your public exhibit?
Absolutely. Not only the exhibit, but I'm writing a book called The Astropsychomicrometer, the story of the ICOM biosensor communicator and controller, and I hope to have this published within the next year or two.
Fantastic. Well, listen, we are winding down. We only have a few seconds left. And if people want to contact you, I assume they can contact the station or through me, and I will provide the contact information because we don't have time to allow you to do it.
Thank you
very
much.
We really appreciate you being here. You were great, terrific. I hope the audience enjoyed it.